13 tells us that we haven't reached our point of perfection yet. It also tells us that we wouldn't assume to have reached the perfect Christian point in our lives yet, that we are still a work in progress. And we are not to look behind, but we look towards the future. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before. So in other words, we are reaching forward, we are looking forward. We're not walking forward and looking back all the time, because what's going to happen if we walk forward and we're looking backwards all the time? We're going to trip up, aren't we? We're going to stray, and we're not going to know where we're going. At some point in time, we're going to have to look towards the front to make sure that we're going in the right direction. And in verse 14, it tells us that we are to press towards a prize. And that prize is forward and not backward. We haven't reached that prize yet. It's still ahead of us. And as we go through this verse, the first thing is that we notice that the verb is to press on, to press, the pressing on, to have this actual thing. It's a doing word. It's something that we are to do. Okay, we are to press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. The word press is a verb. It's an action. It's something that God expects you to do. Now, we know that who writes Philippians? Who's written this letter to the Philippian church? Paul, okay? Did he, at any point of his life, stop preaching the gospel? No, he began church after church, and he wrote letters, and he continued to encourage people in God's word, and encourage them in their walk with Christ. And so God here, through Paul, he says, press toward that mark. And that's a verb. It's an action. We are to be obedient to God, we are to be obedient to Him, and to continue to be motivated for Him. And that takes effort on our part. You cannot press on. If I were to press something, you put something in a press, you have to wind the thing down, and then it gets squishier and squishier and gets squashed eventually. I can press on something, but I have to put in effort. That's effort. I can't just stand back and say, press on that. I've got to do it. I've got to do it. And here God is saying, press, press on. Press on towards that prize. It's an action word. And that means that it's going to take effort. It's going to take effort on your part, on my part. Because it says quite clearly there, what's the very first word of that verse? Verse 14. I press on. Okay? I press on. So it's regardless of what others are doing, I'm looking at myself. Because ultimately, I have to give account before my Lord and my Savior. I have to give account. You got a question, Josh? Oh, just scratching. I have to give account. This means that it's always going to take an effort on my part. I press on. I'm pressing on. And that's the thing for us as a church, for us as a family, individuals, to press on, to move forward, to reach out for that prize. As a church, we're going to have to give account of what we've done with the gospel. The preaching and the teaching of the gospel. As a pastor, I have to give account for you, what I do, and what I present the gospel to you to enable you to go out and to reach others for Christ. The pastor, the teacher. Okay? So, therefore, it's going to take effort on my part to get you equipped. To equip you to reach the world for Christ. To reach your neighbors for Christ. To reach your family for Christ. To reach your workmates for Christ. And so here we are pressing towards the mark. I press. The church presses. And the family leader of the home, the husband, they need to press on with the family. They become the pastor, the teacher of their home. And they press on towards that mark as a family. And how wonderful it is to be raptured together as a family. Can you just imagine? You know, I had this dream many years ago, and Jan woke me up. And I mentioned this before, and I'll say it again. But I was having this wonderful dream. It was a rapture, and I was sitting on the couch with my family. And I said to Jan, "We're away!" And then she woke me up. And we weren't away at all. But it would be so wonderful to know that your family is going to be raptured and to be caught up in the clouds with the Lord. Now, ultimately, every single one of the family is going to have to give account of what they've done with the salvation. I mean, they're not excluded. But it's I. We are pressing on. I am pressing on. You are pressing on. We all have to give account. And it takes a personal effort. So don't blame others. Oh, I didn't press on towards that mark because so-and-so didn't. Or that person put a stumbling block in front of me. Or it was all Satan's fault anyway. Lord, if you hadn't created Satan, then this would never have happened. So it's all your fault. No. But we can do something. God's given us a free will, and we need to put it in action. Put our Christianity in action. I press on. I have to give account. I press on. So I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God. And it's a high calling, all right, isn't it? It's a high calling. There's none higher than God calling you and me to represent Him on earth, to be His ambassador. You represent God on earth. That doesn't make you the Pope, okay? But you are God's representative on earth. Just like the pressing on is a personal one, so will the prize be at the end be a personal one. The Lord is going to give you a prize, and you a prize, and you a prize, and you a prize at the end. It is a personal one. So here in verse 14, says, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Who gives you that prize? God does. The Lord Jesus Christ does. You have to give account. You have to stand before the Lord. And as you give account, if you have honestly pressed forward, pressed on, and we'll look at that in a moment, then of course God will reward you. And you will receive a prize from Him. From Him. And imagine what prize that He can give you. What prize can He give you? You know, we talk about a winning a prize at an event. We might get, at the Olympics, for example, get a gold medal. And I think I'll mention that a little bit later. Just going a little bit ahead of my notes now. But a gold medal is a gold medal, and it's made of precious metal. Well, they try to make it as cheaply as possible, but anyway, it's a gold medal, it's precious. How much more precious can God's prize give to you? He's the creator of all things, the creator of all things, and how precious a prize can He give you. So this personal pressing on and this prize is also a personal one. It is tailored just for you. God has made it just for you. And this prize can be a positive one or it can be a negative one. Now, how can that be? How can you earn rewards that are negative? Well, isn't that what you do with your children? Do you not reward your children for bad behavior?
That's good. Amen.
You reward them by negative things, don't you? And that's exactly what the Lord does. Let's turn Turn with me to 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians, please. So make sure you have your bookmark in Philippians. So 2 Corinthians chapter 5, we'll read from verse 9 through to 11. Now, do you need to be motivated?
Yes.
Well, look at verse 11. Okay, verse 9. Wherefore we labour that, whether present or absent, we may be accepted of him. So we labour on the earth at this point. So we don't have a visible manifestation of God to motivate us or to continue to push us on. We should already be motivated for Christ because of what he has done for us. That should be the motivator. Thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. Verse 9, wherefore we labour, and that's the personal effort, right? Verse 10, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ. All of us have to appear at some point in time before the judgment seat of Christ. Well, that'll be after the rapture. Now, I don't know how that's going to happen, whether it's going to be calling my name forward, and I'm praying that it's not surname alphabetical, or I'm hoping that there's plenty of people with surnames that start with A. Because when it starts with surname B, I'm in trouble. Okay? I'm going to have to give account. I might actually change my surname. Can I change it by depol? Anyway, so I don't know how it's going to be, whether it's going to be from age. Okay, so it's whether at the beginning of creation, so Adam and Eve, right, all the way through to Steve, you know, and all those other people, and then come to me, whether it's the year you were born, I don't know how it's going to happen, but we all have to give account at the judgment seat of Christ. That everyone, now notice that, it's everyone, every single one of us, everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad. So the rewards can be good and the reward can be bad. Or a chastening, if you like. Verse 11, knowing therefore the terror of the Lord. And I believe that many Christians don't have that terror. Many Christians just treat God because he's invisible. And we know he's omnipresent, but he's invisible, he's not here, we don't see him, and we don't come to worship him in a bodily form and things like that. And so we do not have, or many Christians do not have, that terror. But God is holy. And so therefore when we come before him, we also need to be holy. We need to have a healthy terror of the Lord. We persuade men because of that terror. And so it's really important that we realize that it's I press towards the mark for the prize which God is going to give to me. And therefore, I have to make the effort to receive the best prize possible. Because if I don't make an effort, if I don't press on, then that prize will be a negative one. Turn with me to 2 Timothy. I thought at the end of last week's sermon, Eric was going to steal my thunder when he started quoting Timothy. But let's go there ourselves. Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 7 and 8. I have fought a good fight. When you come to the end of your physical life, if you like, what happens? Let's take it a step back. What happens if the Lord were to come back today? Now, I know that's not possible because it's not the Feast of Trumpets. No. He could come at any time. Okay? What if the Lord were to come back this very moment? Could you say, I fought a good fight? And you're going to have to give account before the Lord. You know, I can look on the outward and see the things that you're doing. for the Lord, but is that all you've got to give? Or is that all you are giving? Okay, so verse 7 again, I fought a good fight, I finished my course, I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. So there is this prize that's at stake. And can you honestly say you've done all that you can? And this is what the theme is about this year, is to press on. Not to sit back on your laurels and take it easy and say, well, the others are doing the job, so I don't have to do anything. No, we all have to press on. And the pressing on is an individual one, is a family one, is a church-related one as well. So can we say, I have fought a good fight like Paul did? Turn to Revelation. Revelation chapter 2. And verse 17. Now I suppose it's a few months ago since we preached about this white stone, but verse 17. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit, capital S, Holy Spirit, saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and that's this, the white stone, black stone meant you're guilty, and the sentence of death. And the white stone is that you're declared innocent, and we're only declared innocent because of what Christ did on the cross. The wage of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And so here we have this white stone, and this stone, and in this stone a new name written, which no man knoweth, saving he that receiveth it. So when you get to heaven, and the Lord gives you a white stone, be sure to turn it over to find out what your new name is. And that new name is going to be unique. And don't you neek up on me. Okay, that's another joke no one got. Okay, so that is a unique name that is only given to you. Only given to you. So when you receive that white stone, when you stand before the judgment seat of Christ and everything is done and dusted, and you might have this big pile of ashes and only a few gemstones and gold, but at the end of it all you receive this white stone, and that white stone declares you innocent. The wage of sin is death. So instead of receiving a black stone, you receive a white stone. Make sure you turn it over so you know what your name is, so when the Lord calls you by your new name, you know your earthly names are gone. Here's a new name, a heavenly name. But as it says in verse 17, to him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and a stone, a new name in the stone, a new name written, which no man knoweth, saving he that receiveth it. So it's only known to you and God. Make sure you turn it over. Okay, so in a worldly sense, we receive rewards. And in a race, whether it's doing anything, you might get a gold or a silver or a bronze medal for coming first, second and third. You might, as we do with mathematics or with any competition, have a participation certificate. It means you got nowhere. You're thick as two short planks. But you gave it a go. And here's your participation certificate, because you participated. God will give you a participation certificate. You have participated. You have been included in his family. And he will judge how well you've participated. Okay? So everyone will get a prize. So in a godly sense, your prize will be measured by your effort. Your prize will be measured by your effort. The greater the effort, the greater the prize. The greater the effort, the greater the prize. Obviously, you put more effort into winning a running race, and you win that race, you've deserved it. You've run really well, you've trained really well, you've practiced, you've built up your muscles, and whether it's your arm speed, your leg speed, or whatever it is, you know, you've done well. You've pressed towards that mark, and you've won that race. You've done all that you could. Steroids included. No. No effort, no prize, no rewards. So let's look at 1 Corinthians chapter 3. We looked at 2 Corinthians, that everyone has to give account. So now go to 1 Corinthians at the judgment seat of Christ. God's going to call your name. Rick Lamont. Oops, it's my turn, says Rick. And here he goes. All the people make way for Rick to come through. You're in trouble, Rick. Yeah. You thought you were in trouble with your wife. Well, wait till you stand before the Lord. Verse 11. For other foundation can no man lay. So let every man, at the end of verse 10, it says, let every man take heed how he buildeth on. So we are saved. We've come to a knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. We've placed our faith and our trust in him at his work on the cross. Not my work, but his work on the cross. So I can't do anything. My work is as filthy rags. Okay? So it's not my effort, my efforts that gives me salvation, but we are saved by grace through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. So let every man take heed, how you're building on that foundation of faith. Okay? Verse 11. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. So there's no other way to be saved. No man cometh unto the Father but by him, by the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay? And so no other foundation can be laid except that has already been laid. And we're building on that foundation. Verse 12. Now, if any man build upon this foundation gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, and stubble, and we all do that, maybe we do more wood, hay, and stubble than gold, silver, and precious jewels. But verse 13, every man's work shall be made manifest. So when you're building on that foundation, you're going to have to give account, personally. So Rick's name's been called, and he stands before the Lord. And everything that Rick has done since his salvation is now going to be made manifest. So it's going to look like, Rick, you're going to have some gold, in verse 12, gold, silver, you're going to have some precious stones. And I don't know how much of that you're going to have, only it's between you and the Lord. He'll work that out. All I can see is what Rick is doing for the Lord at this point. But there may also be some wood, hay, and stubble involved in that building. Okay? And so now Rick is standing before the Lord and he is having to give account. And in verse 13 says, every man's work shall be made manifest. So it's got to become visible. Oh no. Now, I don't know whether everybody that's ever been saved or all the saved will ever see all the work that you've done. That's going to be mind-blowing. That's going to be shameful for some of us. I don't know. For the day shall declare it. It's going to be like daylight. And God is God of light. He is light. And so everything will be declared. Because it shall be revealed by fire. As the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. So when you look at the list in verse 12, the gold, silver, and precious stones, wood, hay, and stubble, ask yourself, what's going to be burnt? What's going to burn up and turn to ashes? Well, the wood, hay, and stubble. You know, the precious stones, the gold and the silver, they might melt, but still will be gold and silver, precious stones. And so we come to verse 14. And if any man's work abide, which he hath built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. So what will abide? The gold, the silver, and the precious stones. That will stay, won't it? That will abide. The wood, hay, and stubble is gone. It's just ashes. If any man's work shall be burnt, he shall suffer loss. But he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire. Thank you, Lord. But I'm ashamed. I didn't do more for you. Thank you, Lord, that I'm saved. You know, at the rapture, there's going to be great division. Because all the unsaved are going to be left behind. And all the saved are going to be raptured. So you're there, you're at the judgment seat of Christ because you are saved. You know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. But that's just the first step. You know, everybody says, come, Lord Jesus. That's at the end of the book of Revelation. It says, come. And he says, I come quickly. And we say, in response to that, come, Lord Jesus. But then we've got the judgment seat of Christ. And everything we've done will be revealed. And it's going to be revealed by fire. God's going to put a match to it. So that's why we need to be pressing on, to press on towards that prize. And as a pastor, any pastor, any church, doesn't want to see his flock have nothing to present back to the Lord. He wants his flock to present the gold, the silver, and the precious stones back to the Lord. So it's not a works-based salvation, but it's an outward working and a response to what God has done so that you can be saved. So what is your response? Is it one, pressing on towards that prize? Or is it sitting back and not pressing on? So you've been given a gift that God won't take back, which is eternal life. So you have that as a security. We've just read that. You'll be saved, yet so as by fire. You won't lose that salvation, but you can lose those rewards. And those rewards, God's, just like he's holding out over the balustrades of heaven, he's saying to all mankind, why will ye die? The wage of sin is death. Why? There's no need for anybody to die. There's no need. Christ paid the penalty for sin for all humanity, for all mankind. When he died on the cross and paid that penalty, when he came to heaven and sprinkled his own blood on the mercy seat, he paid for the penalty of sin past, present, and future. So we don't have to crucify Christ over and over and over again. He paid that price. He said, it is finished, and sat down. His job was done. His job was done. And so God wants you to be respectful of that gift. The gift of salvation. And he wants you to treat it with respect. Not to minimize it. Knowing the terror of the Lord. You'll find out the terror of the Lord one day when you stand before him. You'll see the terror of the Lord when he casts at the great white throne judgment the unsaved into the lake of fire. Not that he has any pleasure in that, but what else could he do? He's given a son. His one and only son. He has no more sons to give. And if we reject that means of salvation, and that's the only means of salvation, then what can God do? Can't do anything else. If he did anything else, that would become or minimize the death of Christ on the cross. Or that we could do things better than Christ on the cross. It cost Christ a lot, that salvation. What have you done with it? And so our theme this year is pressing on. Pressing on. Not looking back, but pressing on. Forget about this year, last year, 2016. It's gone. You can't change anything in 2016. But let's press on, looking forward to the prize. Working. We sing a hymn, work for the night is coming, when work is over. When you close your eyes in death, it's all over. Things may have happened during 2016 that has disheartened us. Just when we thought that everything was fine, something came along. And isn't that just, the Lord wants to test us? Or isn't that just like Satan? We're doing something good for the Lord. Well, we can't have that. Put a spoke in there. So, when you're doubling one of your children on your bike, make sure they keep their legs out, because if they put their little toe in there or their foot in there, it gets mangled. Kimberly found that out. I told her to keep her legs out, but no, we had to walk home. Anyhow, we practiced a lot on Kimberly, you'll know. Okay, pressing on then is for us to put those discouraging things aside and look to the Lord and to the future. So verse 13, let's go back to Philippians. Philippians chapter 3, as we finish this morning. I've got a few slides to go, but we'll get there. Looking at the time. Philippians chapter 3, verse 13. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended. So I haven't won any prize yet. It's still dangling before me. It's like the donkey and the carrot scene, you know. If you want to make the donkey go forward, you dangle a carrot in front of him so he tries to reach for that prize. It's still coming. But this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind, and reaching forth unto those things which are before. Forward. Always moving forward. Moving forward. Yes, things will happen. Things happen. Things will come into our lives. Trials, tribulations. Either God-given ones or Satan's stumbling blocks. Something will happen. Something has happened in 2016. God still wants you to press on, pressing on towards that prize. Move on. Wait on the Lord to bless. See the effect of working. And I think that's a real key. If you're a parent, you need to show your children that God is working in their lives as well as the life of your family and in your life as well. See what the Lord has done for me. See what the Lord did for you. And that encourages them to look for the blessings and look for the Lord's leading in their own lives. Doesn't mean we won't come across obstacles, but we can overcome them. Okay, last couple of slides. Listen to what the Lord says. Firstly, Hebrews 12:12. Wherefore, lift up the hands which hang down and the feeble knees. So don't go around like this. Woe is me. I'm such a good Christian. No, lift up the hands that hang down and the feeble knees. Put strength in your legs and move on, pressing on. And God says, lift up the hands which hang down. It's God. He's trying to motivate you. Trying to motivate you. In His strength, we press on. Not in our own strength. He knows the desires of our heart. He knows our failings. But we don't want to use those failings as an excuse to fail. We look to the Lord for the strength to overcome those failings. And press on. Press on. Pressing on. Finally, just a couple more verses. 1 Kings chapter 19. 1 Kings chapter 19. verses 11 and 12. And he said, "Go forth and stand upon the mount before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by. And a great and strong wind rent the mountains." In other words, split them open. Must have been a really strong wind. "And break in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake." And we all know about those, don't we? "But the Lord was not in the earthquake, or as Nathaniel used to say, earthquake. Verse 12, "And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a still, small voice." Are you listening to that still, small voice? Or are you waiting for some real miraculous thing to happen in your life before you act? We're waiting for an earthquake or a sign or a thunderbolt from heaven to motivate us to press on. Or are we just listening to that still, small voice? Listen. Turn to Psalm, final verse, Psalm 62. Listen, when I say final verse this morning, there's lots of verses. Psalm 26, I'm just going to read from 62, 26. 26 and verse 2. "Examine me, O Lord. Prove me. Try my reins and my heart. Are you ready to press on? Press on. Press on. Don't look behind. Look forward. Look forward and listen. Don't look for signs. Just listen to that still, small voice. Pressing on. And that's our theme this year. Not to look behind, and we can look behind and say, well, the Lord has blessed us in the past. But don't dwell in the past. Say, what's the Lord going to do and bless us in the future? The Lord has wonderful things planned for us. We just need to press on. And press towards that prize. Let's close in a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we do thank you, Lord, for the opportunity this morning to open your word. We thank you, Father, for you chastening us in a sense of trying to motivate us so that we indeed will press on. Pressing on. It's a verb. And I need to do that. And the folk here as individuals need to do that. They need to reach for that prize, pressing on. It's a verb. It's an action. And Father, as family leaders, we need to press on. We need to continue to encourage our children, our wives, and also ourselves, Father. In serving you, that they too may press on towards that prize, giving their best, giving their all. And Father, as the psalmist says, we need to ask you to examine us. Are we giving our best? Are we doing our best? Are we giving our all? And Father, we do praise and thank you, Lord, that what we're doing is building upon a foundation which you have laid. Father, it's a God-given foundation. We thank you, Lord, for that salvation. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There's none righteous, no, not one. The wage of sin is death. But Father, all glory be to thee. You came and you died and you paid that penalty of death. And all mankind can be saved and come to that saving knowledge of you. It's not through works which I have done. It's not any works that I've done so that I can boast as I stand before you. Because I can't boast anything. Because my sacrifice, as it were, is as filthy rags. Father, we do pray then that you would speak to us in that still, small voice, and that we would hear and be motivated as we think about that sacrifice on Calvary, to treat that salvation with respect. And Father, even though there may not be any rewards, we still press on. Pressing on. We thank you, Lord, for all that you do. We thank you, Father, for the blessings of knowing you and knowing that you will bless us. And bless us as a church family, as individuals, as families. And we look to thee for that leading and that guidance as we press on. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.